Hi everyone. Today I'm going to talk on the genus Brucella, which is a causative agent for the disease brucellosis, which is very important genetic disease of human beings as well as animals, which involves the reticuloendothelial system of the brain. And this brucellosis caused by this Brucella species has got different names. In human beings, they have got different names, as well as in the animals, they have got different names. Human brucellosis is also known as Malta fever, undulant fever, Mediterranean fever, rock fever of Gibraltar, or gastric fever. So this mainly occurs in Malta, so it's known as Malta fever. Because of the wavy pattern of the fever, it's also known as undulant fever. And Mediterranean area commonly involved many number of cases were seen in that particular area, so it's also known as Mediterranean fever. Whereas if you see the same brucellosis in animals, it will be called as Banks disease, or it's also known as enzootic abortion because it may cause for the abortions among the animals, and it's also known as the epizootic abortion. It may cause for the abortions from the different groups of animals also, and is also known as slinking of calves and ram epididymitis. So these are all the different names for the same disease in the human beings as well as in animals. And also the last one is contagious abortion. So it has got a long history before the invention of this particular bacterium. Sir William Burnett was a physician general to the British Navy, differentiated the various types of fevers affecting the soldiers. So this a particular disease, as I mentioned already, it has got the long history. And during 17th and 18th centuries, there was numerous reports of undulant fevers from all over the Mediterranean, and most were given local names like Mediterranean fever, rock fever of Gibraltar, Cyprus fever, Danube fever. So like this, different names were given for the same disease. So Sir William Burnett was a physician to the British Navy in 1810, and was first person to differentiate between the various fevers affecting the seamen in the Mediterranean. It is thought that Malta became such an important center for the study of undulant fever because many British troops were sent there to recover following the Crimean War. Of course, Crimean War happened between 1853 to 1856. Yes, along with the skillful medical doctors utilizing the clinical thermometers to monitor the disease progress. And later, Geoffrey Allen Marston contracted this Malta fever to him itself, and he described his own case in great detail. See, such a wonderful thing what he was done, and more courageous thing what he was. And in 1887, July 9th, Sir David Bruce, who was a British Army physician and also microbiologist, named this bacterium as Micrococcus melitensis, and he described that the goats were the reservoirs for this particular bacterium. And later Berhard Bang in 1897 described another bacterium or a similar type of bacterium, which was named by him as Bacterium abortus, which can infect the cattle, horses, sheep and goats, and causing for the abortion, contagious abortion among those animals. And this is very important slide, and very important between all the confusions which were focused earlier. Alice Evans, who was an American bacteriologist, in 1920, she discovered the link between the animals and humans related to this bacterium. And because of the similar morphology and the pathological features produced by these two bacteria, like Banks Bacterium abatis and Bruce Micrococcus melitensis. These organisms finally named with the by giving credit to the David Bruce, like Brucella abatis and Brucella melitensis. And now we'll come to the bacteriology, the morphology of this bacteria. They are gram-negative coccobacilli, which are non-motile, non-sporing, but aerobes, and facultative intracellular pathogens. And no doubt, they are fastidious organisms. Their catalase, oxidase, and urease tests all are positive. And this is known as the potential bio-warfare agent. It's a bio-warfare agent, and this causes for the very important animal transmitted disease, that's zoonosis. Now, see the table carefully. We have many number of species in the first column. This Brucella abatis, Brucella melitensis, Brucella suis, Brucella canis, Brucella ovis, Brucella neotamin, and Brucella maris. So the different serovars or biovars as mentioned in the second column, but nothing to worry about these things. Only for the completion sake, I have mentioned this table. And the third column shows the natural host. See, if you see the Brucella abatis, the cattle and bison are commonly affected animals and host, and from them human can get transmission. So the human, it can also act like a human pathogen. Next, the second one is melitensis. It has got three serovars. And goats are the natural host. Of course, the human beings which are having continuous contact with these animals also can affect the infection. Third one is Brucella suis. Pigs are the natural host. And the role of this particular Brucella suis among the human beings is a little controversial. Of course, there is human, it can act like a pathogen, but not like in a Brucella abatis and Brucella melitensis. And next one is Brucella canis. And this canis, the natural host is dogs. Definitely, it can affect the human beings also and produce its pathological manifestations. And now, the transmission of this Brucella bacterium. These Brucella bacteria can survive in refrigerated milk for about 10 days. And they can survive in the ice creams or ice for 1 month. And they can survive for about 4 months in the butter. So this, when you refrigerate this material without proper sterilization, they are infective to from 10 days to 4 months. These are all milk, ice creams, and butter, and all the milk products. So these are mainly transmitted through milk, and milk will be considered as the two unpasteurized or improperly sterilized milk will act as a source for this particular infection. So, how the people will get infection or get transmitted? So, the direct contact on broken skin or through the conjunctiva. When these areas comes in contact with the infected animal blood or urine or vaginal discharges, aborted fetus, placenta, then these bacteria can enter the body through the abraded skin and produce the infection. So the most common dangerous areas for this particular infection are the slaughterhouse or in the farm, the animal farms. Right side you can see the animal farms, the people who are having the contact with these animals can get infection. Last one is, if you see the last two lines, the ingestion. So unpasteurized dairy products like milk, cheese, butter, ice cream, these are all, if they unprocessed, unpasteurized, then they also acts like a much more dangerous the source for the infection. And the another methods of transmission are by means of inoculation, and while you are giving the vaccines to the animals like Brucella abatis strain 19, or RB51, or Brucella melitensis, REV1 vaccines. These are the common vaccines being used in the animals. So while you are giving the vaccines, there may be possibility for accidental injury into the operator, or any congenital splashes of this particular vaccine also can transmit this particular bacterium. And inhalation of infectious aerosols, especially from the aerosols released from the infected placenta, and if the people inhale these aerosols, it may result in transmission. And among the animals, this disease is venereal. So venereal transmission is possible among the animals. After an incubation period of 5 days to 3 months, we can see the clinical manifestations. And what is the population at risk? That means who are the people mainly get affected with this Brucella infection. So basically, even though it's a zoonotic disease, the people will have the contact with these animals by means of occupation. So this also considered as occupational disease. So the people who are having the continuous contact with the animal and their products mainly get infections. So the people who are working in cattle ranches or in dairy farmers, veterinarians, that means veterinary doctors, abattoir workers, meat inspectors, lab workers, all these people are at risk about this particular infection. Hunters and travelers from one place to other place, and consumers of unpasteurized dairy milk. Even today, if you go to the villages, there you can see the people who will consume the raw milk, thinking that they will give much more energy when compared to the boiled milk or boiled milk. So unpasteurized milk or improperly boiled milk may transmit this kind of infections. Now we'll see the pathogenesis. So once they entered the body, ingested by the macrophages but not killed, they multiply intracellularly and they possess the outer membrane protein, which never having the lipopolysaccharide. Since it's a gram negative bacilli, definitely it should have lipopolysaccharide, but the outer membrane protein is not consists of lipopolysaccharide. And from the intracellular, that means within the macrophages, they spread to the local lymph nodes and multiply, and then enter into the blood, produces the bacteremia. From the bacteremia, that is from the bloodstream, they reaches the reticuloendothelial system of the body, like spleen, liver, bone marrow and lymph node. And again, in the phagocytic cells, there is the phagocytosis, and in this process they produces AMP or GMP and also the tumor necrosis factor, which can inhibit the phagolysosome fusion, which finally results the phagocytic activity. And again, from there, from the reticuloendothelial system, like spleen, liver, bone marrow and lymph node, again they enter into the blood, and from there it spreads to the central nervous system and heart, joints, respiratory system, skin and genitourinary system. In all these areas, they are able to produce small granulomas, and these granulomas are responsible for the destruction of involved tissues or the organs. So with this, what you have to learn is these bacteria are intracellular in nature, and they resist the phagocytosis, and from there they multiply in the local lymph nodes, and the produces primary bacteremia, and enters the reticuloendothelial system like liver, spleen, bone marrow, lymph node. On further multiplication, they enters into the blood again. From there it reaches the various organs of the body to produce granulomas. And disease manifestations, produces the disease brucellosis, also known as undulant fever. And why it's called undulant fever? In the below right side, you can see the wavy pattern graph like thing, and where you can see the raised temperature and decreased temperature. So the temperature goes like in a wavy pattern, and that's why it's known as undulant fever. So this brucellosis has got two or three forms. One is acute malignant brucellosis. Number two is relapsing brucellosis or recurrent brucellosis. And third one is chronic brucellosis. First, let us see what is acute malignant brucellosis. This is manifested in the form of intermittent fever. The fever ranges from 100 to 104 degrees Fahrenheit, especially most of the times in the evening times. And people have joint pains and swellings of the involved joints, and profuse sweating will be there. And if these people are suffering with the high-grade fever, body pains, dizziness, and other clinical manifestations like coryza, or if they are present like influenza-like symptoms, then it is known as malignant brucellosis. So the acute brucellosis will be manifested in the form of intermittent fever of typical nature with severe or profuse sweating, joint pains and swellings, and influenza-like. Like that means chills, body pains, and myalgia, arthralgia, all these things are present in influenza, just like that present here also. And here, human acute brucellosis, in 20 to 60% of the cases, the most important manifestation is arthritis. And next one is spondylitis and osteomyelitis. People may suffer with abdominal pain and dizziness also. Here on right side, you can see the arrow mark will show the inflamed joint, how big it is. Just see that how big it is, enlarged above the knee, and that arrow mark will show the abnormal joint with the normal joint on left side. And if you see the hand, the below diagram photograph, if you see, the arrow mark again shows the joint involvement of the ring finger, how the joint is inflamed and enlarged. And next, in 2 to 20% of the cases, the genitourinary tract gets involved, results in arthritis. The photograph will show the inflamed testicles and also the epididymitis, which is the commonest presentation of this particular bacterial infection. And in case of chronic brucellosis, commonly the veterinary people will get involved in this chronic brucellosis. The localized lesions are produced due to the formation of granulomas, which manifest in the form of lumbar spondylodiscitis and also the sacroiliitis. So if you see on right side again, the arrow will show the lumbar spondylodiscitis, which involves the L5 and S1 region. The arrow will mark it, the L5 and S1 region, where it's a spondylodiscitis. See, this is because of the destruction of the involved area. And uveitis is seen in 5 to 10% of cases, and non-caseating granulomas are seen in the lung, and lesions will appear like coin-like appearance. You can see that in the chest x-ray, where you can see with arrow, it's a coin-like thing. If you are able to see in the computer, you can see it, but if you would like to see in your mobile, you may not able to appreciate that. The small coin-like lesions you can see in the lung fields, they are nothing but the granulomas produced by the disease process. And this process resembles like a histoplasmosis of lung and also the tuberculosis of lung. But the thing is, here the lesions are non-caseating granulomatous lesions. And other type of lesions in chronic brucellosis are neurological complications, where the people will suffer with the cyclic bouts of depression and mental fatigue. And another important thing is endocarditis, which may cause for sudden death of individual. And last one, which is very important to remember again, that is, blood donations from infected persons should not be accepted. So even though person volunteered to donate the blood, if once you know that is a person suffering with chronic brucellosis, better to avoid receive the blood from that particular infected individuals. And human brucellosis also manifests clinically among the newborn babies. And those babies, if the pregnant woman infected congenitally with this bacterium, there is possibility for low birth weight babies to born, and premature deliveries are possible, and failure to grow well, and hepatosplenomegaly may present, and difficulty in respiration, and general signs of sepsis also you can see among the neonates who born with a congenital infection with this brucella. So pregnant women always have to be advised to be away from this infected animals to avoid this kind of infections. And next one is diagnosis in human, the brucellosis diagnosis in human beings. There are three, four modalities are there. One is isolation of the organisms from the clinical specimen, but you have to be very, very careful because the laboratory people are always at risk to get the infection from the clinical specimens. So the specimens to be collected are blood, bone marrow, and other tissues like infected placenta, sometimes from mothers also, and the serum agglutination test to be done. But one thing you have to remember, the two samples at 2 weeks interval have to take. Don't depend on one single sample to rule out the possibility of this infection. You have to take the two samples. The time between these two samples should be 2 weeks. That means if you take sample today, but after 14 days you have to take one more sample. Next one is immunofluorescence methods to demonstrate the organisms in clinical specimens. Of course, this method is not very commonly being done. And fourth one is the PCR. This PCR will be done for the diagnosis from the clinical specimens of the human beings as well as from the milk samples of the infected animals. And the next one is the blood culture. The first thing, we will go for the blood culture. So here the medium to be used is tryptic soya broth with the agar. Simple nutrient broth is not sufficient since the organism is a fastidious organism. So tryptic soya broth is required, and along with the solid medium in the same bottle. Of course, you all know that this is a Castaneda's method, and it has to be incorporated with some selective agents like polymyxin B and cyclohexamide to avoid any contamination during the sample collection. And basically they are slow growers, and if you incubate these organisms at the room, what is that, that incubator temperature, that's at 37 degrees centigrade, the growth will be seen after 48 hours only. Don't expect the growth at the end of the 24 hours. Have to wait for 48 hours, then you can see the pinpoint translucent smooth colonies which are non-hemolytic. On right side you can see the arrow is showing the colonies which are small colonies, which are translucent colonies and non-hemolytic colonies on blood agar. So these are the clinical, colony morphology of this bacterium while they are growing on blood agar medium. Next one is bone marrow culture. If you are able to get the bone marrow, that would be the best sample than the blood, because it has got more sensitivity. And next one is the culture of urine and milk, especially from the animals. If you would like to diagnose this condition, you have to go for urine sample and milk the samples, because it's not that much easy to collect the blood from the animals under aseptic conditions. So better to go for urine and milk. And the last one is the bag tolerant. This is an automated system for the blood culture. So this bottle right side, what I am showing is, it's a biphasic medium. It's an old and conventional method, but now we have the newer methods like automated blood culture systems are available. One among them is BactiAlert. So this BactiAlert system has got minimal role in the culture of this bacterium. That's why even today we are depending on the biphasic medium or Castaneda's method to isolate these organisms. Then the serodiagnosis plays a major role. The serodiagnosis plays a major role in the diagnosis of brucellosis. The ELISA is the best method for the detection of IgM as well as IgG antibodies. And another important thing is the standard tube agglutination test, STA, simply call it. Yes, the standard tube agglutination test. Right side you can see the tube agglutination test. And this has to be done by diluting the serum sample, because to avoid the prozoon phenomenon. That's the main problem with this standard tube agglutination test is prozoon phenomenon, otherwise called antibody excess. So if the serum antibodies are excess in number, then the ratio between the antigen and antibody to produce agglutination, then we have to go for serum dilution test. So here the standard tube agglutination, the serum has to be diluted in 1 in 10, 1 in 20, 1 in 40, 80, 160, 1 in 320, like that. And if you see the bottom of the test tubes, you can see the agglutination reaction. So agglutination is there up to 160, and if you see in 1 in 320, there is no agglutination on the bottom. And in the control tube, again, you can see the agglutination. So like this, based on this type of agglutination, we can diagnose the condition by using standard tube agglutination test, where we are going to detect the antibodies against O-lipopolysaccharide of LPS. This killed strain, for this the antigen to be used is the killed strains of Brucella abatis, and it's not useful for the diagnosis of Brucella canis infections. And again, the standard tube agglutination test will be modified with little, which is known as modified tube agglutination test. Here we have to add the mercaptoethanol. We have to add mercaptoethanol to the serum to destroy the IgM antibody. So you can detect only the IgG varieties of antibodies. And most important thing to remember, the problems with this tube agglutination test is prozoon phenomenon, which I already mentioned. To overcome this, we have to dilute the serum sample. And the false positive test also possible in cholera and tularemia, yersinia, and also followed by the vaccination to the Brucella species, you can get the false positive reactions. Next one is Cascada strip test. You can see on the right side the cassette like a small thing below the tube agglutination test, the photograph showing the tube agglutination test. You can see one cassette like, and this is a strip with colored Brucella antigen. On addition of patient serum to this on the well, the below this you can see the arrow, and nearer to the arrow a well is there. So you put a drop of serum in this well, and it spreads on the nitrocellulose strip which is present inside. And if you are able to see the two bands, one T stands for test band and C stands for control band. So if you are able to see the two bands, then we can say that the person is suffering with the brucellosis. And another thing is rapid latex agglutination test. And also this is like in a normal any kind of latex agglutination test, and Rose Bengal card test. In this Rose Bengal card test, Rose Bengal dye will be added. For that you have to add the Brucella abatis as an antigen and sodium azide as a preservative. So this is a combination for the reagent to be used in case of Rose Bengal card test. If really the sample is positive for this brucellosis, then you can see the agglutination. On right side you can see the clumps which shows the test positive. On left side the test was negative, where you can see the uniform suspension. And the radio diagnosis of this particular condition, on x-ray you can see erosion of antero superior corner of lumbar vertebra. Just watch the x-ray findings shown on right side, and the yellow colored arrow is showing the erosions of antero superior corner of lumbar vertebra, and marked osteophytosis. Marked osteophytosis, just below the head of arrow, you can see the osteophytes, just like in a knob-like thing, osteophytes are seen. And this kind of sign is known as Pedro-Pons sign. This Pedro-Pons sign is seen in case of it's seen in case of brucellosis of bone or joints. And next one is Brucella abatis, is also known as contagious or infectious abortion, eradicated in some of the countries in the world, but with this Brucella abatis, human infections also possible. It's a notifiable disease in many countries, responsible for abortions and arthritis, and also it causes for neonatal brucellosis. Already mentioned when I was talking about Brucella melitensis and the cause for the neonatal brucellosis, also the abortus also a causative agent for Brucella neonatal brucellosis, and it also causes for the fever of unknown origin. And the main reason for this abortion in case of animals is the erythritol, which can promote the infections in the fetus and placenta, and also the lack of anti-Brucella antibodies in the amniotic fluid. These are the reasons why the abortions are possible. And next one is Brucella canis. About this, the poorly understood. In case of United States, the prevalence rate is 1 to 19%, and it also causes the abortions in dogs, especially in the last trimester of the pregnancy among the animals, and prolonged vaginal discharge is also another problem with this particular bacterial infection. And next one is Brucella suis. There are biowars, like biowars 1 and 3 are seen worldwide, and they are eradicated in some of the countries like UK, Canada, Holland and Denmark, and low incidence is seen in the Middle East and North Africa. And another thing is the milk ring test. This milk ring test is frequently used to know the Brucella infection in the animal from where we are getting the milk. So for this, what you have to do is a drop of colored Brucella antigen made up of Brucella abortus or Brucella melitensis has to be mixed with hematoxylin dye, and this particular antigen has to be added to the milk in a test tube and incubate this mixture in a water bath at 70 degrees centigrade for about 40 to 50 minutes. And if the test is positive, then you can see, as we shown in the photograph on right side, you can see the ring at the bottom of the milk, and the rest of the milk will look like clear. But whereas on left side and right side, if you see, there remains like that. Those samples were negative for the Brucella infection, Brucella antibodies, but on the middle one is positive for Brucella antibodies. And once you added this antigen in the form of Brucella abortus with the hematoxylin, it produced the a blue colored ring on the bottom, on top of the milk column. So like this, we can identify whether the animal is infected or not by detecting the antibodies in the milk secreted from the infected animal. And positive, the blue ring at the top, milk remains unstained, and negative, no ring and remains uniformly blue. And treatment for the brucellosis, a combination therapy is the best. For adults, rifampin with doxycycline for 6 weeks is best. And for children, rifampin and cotrimoxazole has to be given. But in case of CNS, central nervous system infections, and in case of endocarditis, the treatment has to be prolonged for up to 6 to 9 months. And the prognosis, the recovery is common. It may take days, months or years, but finally recovery, most of the times you can see the recovery among the infected individuals. About 5% of the treated cases will present with a relapse. The people who took the incomplete dosage of treatment regimen are more suffer with relapses or recurrence with this particular bacterial infection. And case fatality rate is 2 to 5% among the untreated cases. The endocarditis caused by the that's case fatality is mainly due to the endocarditis caused by the Brucella melitensis. Now the how to control this brucellosis, its main important the most important thing is the education. So you have to educate all the people who involved in this particular disease cycle or the life cycle of Brucella. The education about the risk of transmission to the farmers, abattoir workers, butchers, hunters, of course to the public also we have to tell about the how it would be transmitted and where personal protection equipment PPE while handling the infected animals or the tissues. That means by wearing the gloves, masks and goggles we can prevent the transmission of the bacteria from the infected tissues or from the infected animals. Last one is avoid consumption of raw dairy products without doing the proper sterilization, like either pasteurization or the proper cooking. You are not supposed to consume those dairy products. And how to prevent? Vaccinate the cattle where they are living in high risk areas. So based on the epidemiological aspects, we have to know what is the high risk areas for this particular infection, and all those animals have to be vaccinated, especially young goats and sheep has to be vaccinated with REV1 vaccine at the age of 4 to 12 months, and calves have to be vaccinated with RB51 vaccine. Remember, there is no vaccine for the human beings. And next one is eradicate the chronic reservoir from the livestock. For that, we have to identify the animal which has been infected with this Brucella species and segregate them. And if not possible to treat them, cull them or kill all the infected animals. And so the take-home message is brucellosis in humans is one of the most prevalent zoonotic diseases. More than 5 lakh new cases per year worldwide are occurring, and bloodstream infection and it produces bloodstream infections and infects the reticuloendothelial system, and thereby it can spread all over the body, and it is a weakening disease that requires long-term antibiotic treatment. That means it causes for the chronic fatigability, and also the because of the joint pains, the people may get crippled. So that's why it's known as a weakening disease, which requires long-term antibiotic treatment. It often results in permanent and disabling consequences also because of the involvement of small joints of the hands and also large joints of the legs. And lesions in lung resembles histoplasmosis, and abortions in pregnant and neonatal abortions are produced among the pregnant women, and neonatal infections also seen, which I already mentioned.